Well, our players are really fired up and excited about the tournament, as I'm sure most of our fans are. And we're going to play a very experienced team in Jacksonville State. They weren't playing great basketball early on, which figures when a new coach coming in, who's we're quite familiar with, and he's quite familiar with us. But they have really great shooters at the 1, 2, and 3, and a small forward at one point this season, three quarters of the way, was shooting over 50% from the three-point line. He's still shooting a great percentage. He's shooting 48% right now and takes a lot of them. And they're very strong with a seven-footer at the five and an outstanding two outstanding four men. So they have a deep, very talented, experienced basketball team, and certainly we look forward to this game, as well as heading up to Indianapolis and having a bus ride instead of a plane ride.
Was it two seed about what you expected, Rick? I mean,
you know, Kenny thought it would be a two, and I just because we were top eight in the RPI and we had number one strength of schedule, kept flip-flopping back one or two, and so it all depends on how much weight they put in strength of schedule, and obviously they did. Oregon losing probably put us in that situation. It didn't really matter to me, to tell you the truth.
Before the season, Rick, somebody said you'll be a two seed in the tournament with what you had coming back and all that stuff. Would you have been pleased? Like, are you pleased?
I was worried about making the tournament at the beginning of the year. You know, I was because I the first thing I and I've told you this many, many times. I felt I overscheduled. You know, we did it. We went through every team that we thought could possibly win their conference, and then when Shinano left, I said we overscheduled. This was a team with 1 9-point scorer returning, and my major concern was to make the tournament. And then obviously we started playing better basketball. Then we changed our goal to top four in the ACC to get the double bye. So yeah, obviously we're delighted with the two seed.
The free throw shooting. What do you do different?
I think when they miss their first couple, they lose a little confidence. But we have the good thing is with the 20-hour rule out, we have now set a free throw record for free throws taken.
What is it?
11 million and something.
How many did you make them?
10.6 million. You know, I think it's a problem. It's more of a problem, Jeff, with the fact that you can't sub good free throw shooters at the end. That's more of a problem. But we've got some things in mind that we're going to do, but I do think having this entire week to prepare, we have spent a lot of time working on it, and if practice indications percentage-wise, is any indication at all, then we'll be improved.
Is the NCAA, obviously, you know, you had a short stay in the ACC tournament, but for a team that doesn't have a lot of tournament experience, can that, you know, even that one game, does that help a little bit entering the NCAA? Or is it just
you know, that was the other reason I made this schedule. Let's face it, you know, when we have played Duke, how many teams in the NCAA tournament? 14?
14, 16 games, 14 teams.
Yeah, we played 16 games against tournament competition. We didn't have a loss with anybody above top 40 RPI. So we're more than ready to play, even though we have a lack of experience because of the competition we've played. You know, it's and you know we play in front of 22,000 people at home. We play in front of some tough road crowds, road games. So we're ready as far as that's concerned. Now we're going to play some great competition, but we have faced great competition.
That the players are maybe a little antsy or a little anxious, given that you guys weren't able to go in the tournament last year, and you know, for some of them, this will be their first experience.
You'd have to ask them that question. I haven't broached that topic. I'd be guessing if I gave you an answer. I think they're excited.
How do you like to watch the bracket show? Do you watch it with the players?
I watched it with a booster club. With the players, and once they announced Louisville, we headed right back and got to practice. So I didn't even see the bracket show. I just saw as soon as they named Louisville. That was it.
Did you watch any of that stuff last year? The selection show
or yeah.
any of the tournament games?
Yeah, we did.
You did? I mean, what?
Oh, this, last year being, no, I did not watch it. I forgot. No, last year was not good. No, I did not watch it.
Try
to forget last year.
What do you think of the overall bracket, the South region, I mean the Midwest region?
I think it's very tough. You know, the interesting thing is, the way I look at all brackets going into it is, you prepare for two games. You don't look anything beyond two games. I can't even tell you after that. So, you know, you put all your emphasis on that one game, and then you, if you're lucky enough to win, you prepare for the second game. And, you know, honestly, we've all watched about 15 films of all the teams, and I couldn't pick the second game. Two extremely talented teams, and I have no idea who would win that game.
Michigan.
Oh, Oklahoma State. You know, I'm just concerned right now with beating Jacksonville State and trying to come away with a victory, but I could not pick the second game. That's two great backcourts, two teams that would cause a lot of problems for us. So let's, you know, who knows? Now, I have seen Michigan live and Minnesota twice, and they're a very good basketball team. Obviously, they just won the Big Ten championship, so, and Oklahoma State's the best offensive basketball team in the nation.
Were you glad to be out away from Richard Bracken?
I don't think they would ever put me with Richard. I mean, that would be cruelty beyond anything. The NCAA can be cruel, but not that cruel.
Were you aware that you two are you're the first father-son duo to be coaching the same tournament? There have been obviously John Thompson and some,
right.
you know, Bryson Homer and all those guys, the Drews, but you're the first father-son to coach in the
I have.
I'm
really proud of Richard because he received the Coach of the Year award. I'm sure he's going to receive a couple of National Coach of the Year awards. He had the biggest turnaround in college basketball. But I'm most proud of the way he handled adversity. You know, it's one thing he's handled success with humility, but he always kept his head high. And if somebody said to him, you know, one time I remember last year, I said to him, boy, you're not drawing too well. He said, I don't blame the people. I wouldn't come either. And then I said to him, are you taking a lot of abuse at all? He said, whatever I'm taking, I deserve. We won eight games. We deserve it. And I said, you've got to get Big Ten players in there. You don't have anybody on honorable mention, first, second, third team. He said, I'm working on it, Dad. Thanks for your great advice.
When you were in Miami last year during the tournament, what did you miss about the tournament not being a part of it?
You know, I was so dejected about somebody from my family doing something like that I just wanted to block everything out. I didn't watch the games, you know, I did watch the final game. Actually, I watched Villanova. I'm good friends with Jay Wright, so I watched the final couple of games, actually.
Which, how do you, with the other guys of you in your trio, with Kevin, do you pay attention to what they're doing?
Oh, I follow religiously. I mean, I spoke to Kevin last night, and he said, Coach, I need some advice about Virginia. I said, call Notre Dame, don't call me. you know, I did say we played a really good first half down there, and we altered our style against Virginia, and really proud of Kevin Keats. He has done a phenomenal job. Kevin Willard has done an incredible job. Mick Cronin, incredible job. My son, Scotty Davenport, that Bellman has done an incredible job. I'm really, really proud. These are all Louisville assistants that we're all very proud of here in town, and it's just very special to see them have. And they're not having good years. They're all having great years. So, you know, I even following Bellman, Scotty's teams always have played great offense, but now they're playing terrific defense for the first time, and that's when you have great offense combined with great defense, you got a legitimate shot at winning it.
This week, do you reset anything, or is it just like every day, like throughout the course of the season, it's just the same process, or do you reset?
No, the only difference is we have more meetings and more media obligations. Outside of that, it's all the same prep. It's all you don't want to get the players nervous by changing things. I try to relax more and let them know this is the fun time of their life, and you know, so we don't get too bent out of shape. But our team knows we're playing a very dangerous opponent right now.
Do
And just the last four games are far different than before that. They've got adjusted to what they're doing, and they shoot it really well, and they're very powerful at the 4 and 5 spot.
How many films do you typically watch on a film of your first round?
Me personally?
Well, anybody on
the staff's going to watch. Each staff member will watch probably 10 Jacksonville State games.
Different games,
different games. Like say David will take, he'll have three opponents of Jacksonville State. And then everybody had three games to watch. Then we came back this morning and we talked about, we got everybody's opinion on how we think we should play them, every aspect of what they do. Now they change defenses, you know, they'll play 1-3-1, they'll play triangle and two, they'll play a 2-3, 3-2. They'll pressure, they'll change a lot. They have a lot of different defenses.
This is probably just a curiosity thing to me, but if you're saying that they've changed so much, they're playing so much better the last five or six games, but does it really do much good to watch the early game? What do you get out of watching the early game?
We focus more on the last, you know, the last 10 games that they play. But, you know, it's just the same way with, if you watched Oklahoma State, the first five league games, they didn't have a W. And then all of a sudden they get used to the new coach, they start playing better, he makes adjustments, and you know, it's how you play at the end. You know, I thought we had a great season, not a good season, a great season for what we were turning, but I never felt at any point in time very confident that we had a great basketball team. Last 10 days, I felt really, really confident that we made great strides in the last 10 days. We really thought we were going to win that tournament going to New York. But obviously, we fell into a team that was playing great basketball, and we didn't get the job done.
What were the things that made you?
They were just paying attention to the defensive end of the court, and I thought we really made great strides offensively in the half court as well as the full court. And a lot of that has to do with the play of Mango Mathieng, he's and Dang Adele. Those two guys really came on in the last 10 days.
Jacksonville, do they do a lot of similarities when he was at Western? A lot of the stuff, and obviously different personnel, but do they do anything similar to Ray?
He's probably got a little better team than the Western teams that we faced.
Getting back with your son, did you get a chance to talk with him either last night or this morning? And did he hit you up for any advice as well?
You know, Richard was with me when we went to the Final Four, and I just try to be a father. I don't try to be a strategist with him at all. I just try to be his dad, and he... If I try to be a strategist with him, then I didn't train him well enough. The same thing goes with all the other guys. I don't have to give Kevin Willard or Mick Cronin or any of these guys any advice. They're all tremendous by themselves. Now, if we play common opponents, like if we were fortunate enough to win and Michigan win, I'll speak to him about Michigan, certainly, if we have common opponents. But Richard's a real sharp young man intellectually, and the best part about Richard is his humble personality. He really, really handled adversity, and now he's really handled success well. And he's got a good team, and they're all coming back.
They split with Michigan. I know they beat him.
Yeah, they beat him at home in overtime, and then they lost in the I don't know of any team that would have beat Michigan in the last two games that they played. Oh, my God. You know, it's the interesting thing about the pros as well as college. There's such a premium on shooting the basketball, more so than the big center, that everybody, when you look at these teams, you just, like, we watched Iowa State play and against Oklahoma State, and the way they shoot the ball is incredible. And that's the biggest note. If you said to me, what's changed, you know, the rules have changed, what's changed college basketball, is now we're all, including myself, because of the change, we're all recruiting much more offensive basketball players than defensive-minded basketball players. Everybody's going after the guys who can shoot the ball.
Is that what scares you the most about Jacksonville State, these 3 points?
It scares me about Jacksonville State, Oklahoma State, Michigan. They all shoot the ball awesome at multiple positions. I mean, their center, their 7-foot center, who's a very good basketball player, you know, they get, their power forwards go 250, and their center goes 245.
Do you
you know, honest, you know, he has constant migraines. You know, he really does. And, you know, you have to give him medication. Like, he missed it, practice this morning because of it. And, you know, he was probably watching film on his center because he gets, usually when he has a big guy to go against, he gets migraines.
Rick, what are your, what is sort of your...
And honest, his defense gives me migraines at times.
What is sort of your opinion of Ray Harper when you kind of think of him as a coach, or how you know him?
Ray's a terrific coach, you know, at every step along the way. And, you know, I've got great respect for Ray, great guy. Terrific coach and plays a lot of different defenses. And, you know, in his first year, he's got this team in the NCAA. So, had Weston in the NCAA as well. And so many programs, you know, you see so many programs just today are in such a rush because of March Madness that they lose patience. And what they do is they hire someone, then it sets the program back three or four years again. And, you know, sometimes patience is a virtue. And you know, I just look at our coaches. One, Richard, last year, Mick Cronin about 6-7 years ago. They were all over him, and now he's has one of the premier programs in the nation. 4 years ago, they're all over Kevin Willard, and now he got Big East Coach of the Year last year, and now he's got him in the hunt again. And it takes time to build a culture and build a program. But today is not a, you know, today is. I mean, when you got a president tweeting out policies. I mean, everybody's looking at the moment, you know. And
what do you need to get from your five spot for your team to be successful, Mark?
We're getting it. We're getting it. Five spot's not a weakness of ours. We're getting it. That's one of the reasons why I think we've made rapid improvement in the last 10 days is because of the five spot. Got two really, really good five men.
Did you?
Three, two. I'll include Mats. Mats may have to play in this game because they are very tough in the low post.
Donovan said that struggling last week, but did you feel like you had to say anything to him?
Donovan took bad shots in that game. You know, he was trying to show everybody he's a great shooter rather than being a great basketball player. And I said, you've already proven that you're a great shooter, son. You got to play the game of basketball and let the game come to you. That's the most impressive thing walking away about Duke with Kennard. You hear when you're watching Duke on TV and you say, they did an awesome job on Kennard. He was only 2-for-4 and they kept the ball away from him. They didn't keep the ball away from him. That was Kennard. He lets the game, if you notice, he always has great second halves. He just lets the game come to him, gets everybody involved, takes the shots if they're there. If they're not there, he just passes the ball. He creates movement. He's just a very cerebral basketball player that lets the game come to him. And that's the analogy I told Donovan. I said, that's what makes him so special. He lets the game come. He's not trying to score, you know, 16 points in the first 2 minutes of play. And that's what Donovan did the other night. I think it's just taking uncontested shots. We only took 6 challenge shots in the last game. Everybody said, well, Duke zone hurt us. We're 4 percentage points higher playing against zone than we are man. And we had wide open shots in that basketball game. I mean, when do you see Quentin Snyder shoot an air ball? Donovan had 2, Deng had 1, Quentin had 2. Wide open shots. We just missed. And sometimes, yeah, the zone worked because we missed. You know, it happens that way. But I think that the missed free throws got into our head a little bit, too.
Is there anything to knowing that you already played at Bankers Life this year? Does that help you guys at all, do you think?
I wouldn't think so. You know, I'm because I spent 8 years in the pros, the one thing you find out, statistically speaking, that you never practice. Like if I was the Knicks coach or the Celtic coach, you never practice where you play. So you go into these arenas and you never shoot around. It never affects your percentage. So it's not an advantage or a disadvantage at all. You know, it's probably, if we're lucky enough to get to Sunday, you know, you probably have a lot of fans rooting against us.
Look at the overall picture. How do you see this NCAA tournament this year? Just looking at the big picture.
How long you thought 12 or 13? Yeah, I really haven't looked at the big picture, Russ. I can't tell you even the other regions. I mean, we're just so tuned into our bracket that I don't even know who's playing in the other brackets except from my assistant coaches.
Do
getting back to what Jeff was talking about with the arenas, is do you see though a difference that from playing in, you know, Bankers Life than say maybe Lucas Oil, which, you know, typically the NCAA has gone to there in Indianapolis?
Well, we play at Syracuse, and it doesn't bother us. You know, like I said, if you're a good shooter, you're going to shoot well in a dome, and you're going to shoot well in a small arena. If you got guys that don't shoot the ball well, it's the same thing. I'm sure Iowa State would shoot it in any facility in the nation.
What's been the difference the last four games? I think that Deng has really just been so efficient offensively. He seems much more confident.
Well, we had a lengthy conversation about a week ago, and you know, he was disappointed in the type of season he was having. And I told him what I felt, and we had a long talk about it. And I said, now you've got a new season. The best thing about it is, you know, you can just start fresh and just play. And what I basically told him, I said, you know, all you guys are putting way too much emphasis on scoring and not enough in being a great player. Like I told him, you've got to be, I said, I'm shocked that you don't lead our team in steals, and almost to the point where I think you only had 7 steals in conference play. I said, I'm shocked that Donovan has more steals than you. I'm shocked that you're not the second leading rebounder on the team. I said, I've always envisioned you as somebody who can drive, shoot, pass, play great defense, and you're just focused in on becoming a scorer. And if that's the case, you'll never reach your potential. So we had a nice conversation, and I'm hoping that he's taking it to heart about just becoming an outstanding basketball player at all phases of the game.
Rick, did you initiate that conversation? Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Did that kind of go back to what you were talking about? Not just the emphasis that, you know, there has been on finding offensive players, but just society as well. Just, you know, everyone's looking to score, not necessarily rebound or get steals.
Well, I think that was the great thing about coaching Terry Rozier. And that was the great thing about coaching the championship team, because they were all just focused in on it wasn't about scoring, it was about winning and focused in on doing everything. You know, even Luke Hancock, who wasn't the quickest guy, was a great steal guy, anticipated well, great passer. You know, and I look at a great basketball player as somebody who can make the pass, get in the paint and score, get in the paint and pass, throw lob passes. You know, a lot of things that Quentin Snyder does on offense. Now, he's going to need to pick up his defense in the first round. He's going to need to pick it up with the guards he's facing.
He was?
Yep. He's playing against outstanding guards. I mean, Drumright is a really big-time scorer.
How close is he, though, to giving you everything you want out of that position? I mean, offensively, I guess.
He's as good as it gets offensively. I mean, you look, he's going to play the guy that he's going to guard. Shoots a lot of threes, is an excellent foul shooter. You know, they have scoring people at the 1-2s and threes. And then sometimes you hope for weakness at the 4 and 5, but they're not weak at the 4 and 5. They're strong at the 4-5 as well.
What's been the difference with Ray in the last 4 or 5 games where he's seemed to pick it up and he's hitting that high post, the passing has really come along?
I think our front court's playing really good basketball. I mean, think of it this way. Q and Donovan, and I know why. We had some phantom calls in that game, but there are phantom calls all over basketball. I don't know if you guys noticed it with Barry from North Carolina, the play there. He wasn't within, Joe Barry, he wasn't within 3 feet of the guy, and they called a foul. Q on our fast break, Donovan's second block. Well, what happens is it puts you, when you're like us and you don't have strength in the backcourt numbers-wise because of the situation we're in. Now you're putting those guys to the bench. That's a major factor in the game. So if I question it, you know, a lot of people say, well, that's why we want to go to 6 fouls. I said, no, we need to not make phantom calls, you know, because phantom calls happen a lot on the break. The referee's hustling to get down, and he sees the guy go in and doesn't see the contact because he's trailing the play, and he wants to give that and-one motion. And that puts your players to the bench. But that being said, 2 of our key guys were on the bench in that basketball game, and we still had and they didn't play a good game. And we had a great shot at winning that game because our front court played so well. So that's a good thing.
Is there anything you can do to, like, can potential?
Yeah, we do, but it's not just us. I mean, we've had a share of poorly officiated games, but I'm sure that Roy would say the same thing. If you look at Big, I'm sure Mike or everybody would say the same thing. You know, it just has to, and you have to cut a break with the officials because they're trying to referee a different game now. Now, I will say this, when I watch Minnesota play against Michigan State, that didn't look like the new rules to me, you know, when I was watching that, both ways. And then when I was watching Big 12 basketball, it didn't look like ACC basketball. So they're still refereeing the game different by conference, I have found. When I watched Seton Hall play Villanova, that was an old-fashioned Big East slugfest. Great game, one of the best games I've watched all year.
What kind of challenge does that present when you have all these different conferences with different styles of play? You get them all together in either the same region or, you know, later on in the Final Four?
Well, the NCAA will be under the jurisdiction of the head of officiating, and he will tell them how to officiate. It'll be a blanket policy of this is the way it's going to be officiated.
Anything else for Coach?
Good. All right, see you guys in Indy.